the extreme kind of asceticism, another word I'm not sure if I'm pronouncing it right, but if I just say it confidently enough, see, this is the problem with doing my undergraduate degree online, is that there are a lot of words that I know what they mean, I know how to use them, not a clue how they should be pronounced. Hi and welcome to my channel Explain, my name is EK and this video could well be subtitled Disabled People Always Existed, Huge If True. This video is entirely the result of my incandescent rage caused by a Facebook comment that I saw several years ago that has stuck with me. The comment was describing a controversy in the world of kind of historical reenactment of pre-modern eras. I think specifically the 1600s. The commenter was kind of discussing this little kind of like dumpster fire that they'd had in that little corner of the internet about mobility aids. And this commenter was kind of lamenting that, oh, well, using mobility aids is historically inaccurate since, to paraphrase, disabled people simply did not survive past childhood in the pre-modern world.
Oh, okay. I didn't even have time to tell you how wrong you are. Actually, it's gonna bug me if I don't.
I am disabled. I use a powered wheelchair. Her name is Anne Rolin and I love her dearly. I'm also a historian. I don't specialise academically in disability history. I tend to focus more on gender history, but I do specialise in pre-modern history, roughly kind of the 11th to the 16th centuries. And I know, without a shadow of a doubt, that the idea that all or almost all disabled people simply did not make it past infancy or youth prior to kind of the late 18th and 19th centuries is categorically incorrect.
That's just totally wrong. It's just wrong. It's just wrong.
So when we have a
not true. It's just not true.
But never fear, I'm here to disabuse you of that notion and also to take advantage of this person's obliviousness to use as a jumping off point for a wider discussion about disability history and the dogma of progress. Some brief housekeeping. I need to set some slightly porous parameters for this discussion. I'm going to be mainly talking about pre-modern history. The dawn of modern history in Europe is usually placed around the time of the French Revolution in 1789. So when I say modernity, I'm generally talking about like the very end of the 18th century onwards. And so pre-modern history is anything before that. I will be going quite far with some of these examples, both geographically and chronologically, but my research, both primary and secondary sources, which I will of course list down below, has mostly fallen in kind of the medieval period in Western Europe because that is where I can usually be found. This video is going to include kind of repeated discussions of ableism, including words to describe disabled people or disability that we would not use today, whether for reasons of inaccuracy or insensitivity. I'm also going to discuss eugenics and kind of the institutionalization of disabled people. Usually with trigger warnings, I give timestamps, but I don't know if that's really going to be possible for this one because it's kind of continuous. Some of this stuff is difficult for me to talk about. It was quite difficult to research, and so I would ask viewers to come towards this with compassion and to enter any discussions in good faith. How am I so confident that this person was incorrect? I'm glad you asked. I know they're incorrect because there are literally so many examples of disabled people across pre-modern history, across the world, across the entire historical spectrum. Disabled people existed. They ran businesses, they ruled countries, they wrote, they worshipped, they worked, they married, they had families, they lived, laughed, and indeed loved, just like they do now. Was the pre-modern era some sort of utopia for disabled people? Absolutely not. But honestly, neither is now. Before I get into the meat of the examples, I just want to clarify some terminology. First, some of the texts that I'm discussing have been translated into English, usually from Latin, which means that the translator's kind of style and preferences influence the eventual translation. For example, one translator might translate kind of a Latin word that describes a condition or disease into the word that they feel is kind of its modern counterpart. So some kind of palsy might be translated to a stroke, melancholy to depression kind of thing, which of course influences the way that we interpret the English text. Another kind of terminology potential quicksand is whether we can apply the term disabled to pre-modern individuals. By using this term, do we risk anachronism? Is the descriptor so loaded with kind of modern accoutrements that it would be unrecognisable to pre-modern individuals that I'm going to discuss? To surmount this obstacle, several scholars of disability history, like Irina Metzler, have opted to use impairment when discussing these health conditions, arguing that disability, quote, implies certain social and cultural connotations that medieval impaired persons may not have shared with modern impaired people. For simplicity, I am going to use the term disabled because I am not just looking at the kind of physical realities, but the social ones as well. In this thread, I'm kind of following the social model of disability, which holds that society's inaccessibility is disabling to those who need accommodations, with kind of disable being used as a verb. Now, my attachment to the social model is not absolutist. No matter how inclusive society is, it will not change the fact that I have chronic pain. That might make me able to participate in society more, to have a better life, and to mitigate the kind of unchangeable aspects of my chronic health conditions. But the social model's relevance here is to highlight that it is not simply the kind of medical, biological, physical facts of an impairment which are relevant to disability history. It is the way that these individuals were affected because of that impairment. That is disability, and so that will be the word I use where I see fit. So on with these examples, I think we shall go in reverse chronological order, starting with George III. George III's mental illnesses are pretty well known. There was a film about it called The Madness of King George, and George kind of just sneaks in under the pre-modern boundary because his initial illness in 1788 began, according to his biographer John Cannon, by the king, quote, sleeping badly, hoarse with relentless talking, unsteady on his feet, mentally confused and occasionally violent. And he was restrained using a straitjacket and a special chair that he mournfully kind of referred to as his coronation chair. George did have periods of recovery, but from kind of 1810 onwards, these became fewer and further between, and his son and heir, who incidentally he didn't get on with very well, ruled on his behalf as regent. So that is actually why the period from 1811 to 1820 is known as the Regency. Next is Gottfried Götz von Berlichingen. I do not speak German. I used to be able to speak French kind of passingly well, but not that great, and I definitely have lost some of my touch on that. Saying that, in one of my classes that I took, it was my medieval men and masculinities class, which was one of my favourite classes. I mean, there wasn't a single class I didn't enjoy. And if you want to know more about the classes that I took as part of my master's, my last video is about that, so go and look. But in this class, we were reading like some kind of chivalric romance, and it was originally in French. And the article that we were reading, she quoted a line from the original poem in French. And I don't think it was in Middle French. I think it had been modernized, but it was still kind of very formal, poetic French. And I spent ages, I was like, I can figure this out. Because, you know, I can read French okay. I can't speak it well at all. But I spent ages figuring it out and checking the tenses. And I was so like, oh my God, so proud of myself, so excited. And I looked in the footnotes, and there's a fucking English translation there ready. Which I'm not bothered about, like, oh, I wasted my time, I could have just looked. That's not what was relevant. The fact was, it robbed me of an opportunity to look really clever. Because now, if I put the English translation in, my professor would just be like, oh, well, she read the footnote. No, I'm clever and very, very special. And you know, sometimes I want to be a little bit of a teacher's pet. I was not a teacher's pet in school, so I'm making up lost time. Anyway, so Gottfried von Berlichingen, also known as Götz of the Iron Hand. Götz was a German mercenary who lost his right hand in 1504 during the War of the Succession of Landshut. He had prosthetics, one of which was able to hold objects, and he continued a glittering career in the arts of war. He also wrote poetry and may offer us the earliest surviving example of the phrase lick my ass, and you can thank my dear friend Jamie for that piece of trivia. Next is Joan of Scotland. Joan of Scotland was the third child of James I of Scotland and his queen Joan Beaufort. Joan had one brother, the future James II of Scotland, and five sisters, Margaret, Isabella, Eleanor, Mary and Annabella. All her sisters made marriages in Europe and Joan spent some time in Europe while marriages were being discussed, but eventually she returned to Scotland and married James Douglas I, Earl of Morton. Joan is usually described by kind of early modern historians as, quote, deaf mute, and apparently was known as Muta Domina, which is Latin for mute lady. I also read that she used sign language, but all mentions of that on different websites refer to the same one article, and I could not find that article for love nor money to kind of fact check it. So she may have, that's not saying it's not true, but I wasn't able to verify it. Joan and her husband died in the same year and were buried together at Dalkeith Collegiate Church. Their tomb was topped with an effigy of the couple, which may provide the world's earliest surviving image of a deaf person. Between the Reformation and kind of the centuries gone by, the monument has been heavily weathered, but in 2005 a canopy was erected to protect it from the elements. Returning to monarchs, we have Henry VI of England. He ascended to the throne of England in 1422 at the age of only 9 months. In August of 1453, he had, according to his biographer R.A. Griffiths, a quote, severe mental collapse accompanied by crippling physical disablement. Theories for this illness kind of range from schizophrenia to depression, but whatever it was, it rendered him unable to rule. This power vacuum kind of exacerbated existing tensions between some of Henry's nobles, and it was a key factor in the Wars of the Roses. In 1471, having been taken captive by the victorious Yorkist faction under Edward IV, Henry was murdered in the Tower of London, almost certainly on the orders of Edward IV. In a slightly lower rung of society is Marjorie Kemp. She was a late medieval mystic who turned to religion after experiencing several months of a debilitating illness, usually characterised as depression, maybe some kind of postpartum depression because it was after the birth of her first child. That was a short-term situation and their illness did eventually disappear, but in later life her biographer Felicity Riddy writes that she suffered further illnesses which made Kemp less mobile than before. Charles VI of France was King of France between 1380 and 1422 during the period of the Hundred Years' War between England and France. In his 20s, Charles began to experience mental illness, including periods of psychosis, and also not knowing who he was or recognising his family. He also believed at one point that he was made of glass and that he would be shattered if anybody touched him. This incapacity, quite similar to Henry VI, was a key factor in the Hundred Years' War, which I outlined from the kind of English perspective in an earlier video. Going way further back, Tutankhamun. Chances you've heard of Tutankhamun and seen some of the treasures that are so famously associated with his tomb in the Valley of the Kings, but it's less widely known that he was disabled and used what we might call mobility aids or assistive techs. For this segment, I am very grateful to have the words of Jesse Zander, an anthropologist, an author, and probably the most knowledgeable person I've ever had the pleasure to know. They explain that Tutankhamun had, quote, a cleft palate, autoimmune problems that caused inflammation and chronic pain, a curved spine, and his left foot was clubbed, so he walked with a cane and was buried with more than 100 of them to use in duets. He also had a specially adapted hunting chariot to allow him to ride it and hunt with a bow and arrow while sitting down, as the standard model required the hunter rider to stand unaided. But he could not race chariots, even though he was a big fan of the sport, as chariot racing required the rider to stand unaided and maintain their balance at high speed. His hunting chariot was also buried for him for use in duets, and he was depicted using a racing chariot on the walls of his tomb to allow him to do so in the afterlife through the magic of words and images, which was central to the pharaonic faith. Further, Jesse points out that he lived with multiple disabilities, but that his death was likely unrelated to his disability. If you want to stand witness to more of Jesse's incredible scholarly wisdom, you can follow them on Twitter and check out their book. the real J.R.R. Tolkien, the man who created Middle-earth. Jesse is also participating in the Twitter History Book Fair from the 26th to the 27th of November, so send your questions their way and maybe snag a free copy of their book. Thank you so much, Jesse, and thank you so much for all the knowledge that you provide to me and our friends. Slightly further back than Tutankhamun is the Amesbury Archer, a Bronze Age burial near Stonehenge, so named for the myriad arrowheads that were found in the grave. He had a missing kneecap and a bone infection that would have caused long-term pain. Now, these are all quite concrete and individual examples. Many of them represent the elite of the elite, that real kind of apex of the feudal pyramid. But from that social kind of strata, we have evidence that provides both more examples of disabled people, but also demonstrates how the elite kind of treated or perceived disabled people. And I am, of course, talking about fools. So the aforementioned Irina Metzler uses the working definition of a medieval fool as, quote, the approximate equivalent of the person with intellectual disability. There were also individuals without intellectual disabilities who kind of took on this role as artificial fools. And the kind of fool's role was that of a court entertainer, but the relationship between them and kind of the court has been characterised quite chillingly by some historians as like a quasi-pet relationship. Most of the evidence we have for fools is in the late medieval period. This increase in the presence of fools was slightly because of the increased wealth of royal courts and noble households, both of which might retain the services of a fool, such as the Countess of Artois and Burgundy, who apparently had a, quote, fool of diminutive stature, Grand Master of the Teutonic Knights, hosted in his court between 1399 and 1409, quote, a stuttering herald, a blind poet or minstrel, some dwarfs, various cripples, and a lame man. The electors of Saxony had a fool named Klaus von Ranstead, or Klaus Narr. Klaus was fool to the electors of Saxony for 50 years. Metzler describes him as a living heirloom. England even had a specific office in the early 1500s called Keeper of the King's Fool. Will Summers, fool of Henry VIII, was kept by a man named William Seton. Seton's role as keeper is characterised by historic England as kind of a carer of the king's fool, indicating that Will was unable to manage his life independently. Cardinal Thomas Wolsey, in the twilight of his usefulness to the king, gave a fool named Sexton to Henry, along with Hampton Court Palace. Sexton was provided for by the royal coffers. A woman named Jane, sometimes called Jane the Fool, lived at the court of Mary I, and before that entertained both Anne Boleyn and Catherine Parr in their respective queenships. Jane the Fool and Will Summers actually appear in one of the most famous paintings of the Tudor royals. Now on display at Hampton Court Palace, the family of Henry VIII shows the king with all three of his children and his late wife Jane Seymour. The proxemics of the scene indicates the somewhat unstable hierarchy amongst Henry's children, particularly his daughters, but at the far ends of the painting there is Jane the Fool and Will Summers. In Scotland, financial records of the royal treasury in the early 16th century show a great number of fools. Some are connected to and paid for by the king, but there are others recorded as fools for different noblemen and knights. There are records of cash payments to these individuals, but also transactions relating to the providing of clothing. One fool named John Bute even had a servant, which may have been kind of analogous to the keeper of the king's fool in England at that time. So some examples from the records of Scotland's treasury, and there's a few examples, and I'm going to read most of them out, not because they're relevant, but because I had to go through all of these financial records for my dissertation, and I will be damned if I'm not going to squeeze a little more use out of them. In the second volume of Scotland's accounts, covering 1500 to 1504, it says, item in St Andrews to Wallace the Fool by the King's command. Item the 7th day of January to Joke or Jock or Jack Fool in Dundee by the King's command. In volume 3 of Scotland's accounts, which covers from 1506 to 1507, we have John Bute and his servant. There's a record of a coat being given to Swagger, who is the fool of Sir William Murray. A coat is given to a fool by the king, who is at Linlithgow. In volume 4 of the accounts, which covers 1507 to 1513, a coat is given to a fool called Billy Howe by the king's command, and 2 shillings is given to Lord Hamilton's fool. The role and kind of treatment of the fool is complex. There are 2 texts by Irina Metzler, which I have researched for this, and one of them is just about fools. So obviously I will put the details in the description box if you want to check that out. To explore an even wider layer of the general population, I now turn to saints. Throughout my postgraduate degree, I wrote a lot about saints, and most of the ones I studied either lived or were venerated in the medieval period. Some of the most well-known saints to kind of medieval Christians were disabled. St. Cuthbert, for example, who is quite an important saint in Scotland, and I think his relics were, I don't know if they're there anymore, at Durham. St. Cuthbert had a leg injury that did miraculously heal, but left him with a little pain for the rest of his life. The Vita of St. Cuthbert, written by the famous historian Bede. Bede writes, "For Cuthbert's knee was seized with a sudden pain and began to swell into a large tumour. The nerves of his thigh became contracted, and he was obliged to walk lamely, dragging after him his diseased leg, until at length the pain increased and he was unable to walk at all." Then, after relating the miracle in which he was able to walk again, it does mention that, "But because the swelling was on his thigh, though it died away to all outward appearances, struck into his inwards, he felt a little pain in his inside all his life afterwards." St. Margaret of Castello lived in 13th century Italy, and her story is explicitly tied to her disability. A 20th century Vita by William Bonnewell describes her as, quote, "deformed from birth." He writes, "She was so small that it was evident she would never attain normal height. In addition, she was hunchbacked. As the right leg was much shorter than the left, it was obvious that the girl would be lame. All this was bad enough, but a week or so after her birth, her parents discovered that she had still another handicap. She was totally blind." Margaret ended up in the care of the church. She first lived with nuns and then became a secular member of a Dominican community. She was beatified? See, this is the problem with doing my undergraduate degree online, is that there are a lot of words that I know what they mean, I know how to use them, not a clue how they should be pronounced. I'm going with beatified. Something, she was that in 1609 and canonised in 2021. Hildegard of Bingen was a 12th century mystic, theologian and abbess from Germany who suffered periods of severe illness that she, according to the Hildegard scholar Lauren Cole, quote, "interpreted as divine message that she should speak about her visions." At one point she had an extended period of illness. Sabina Flanagan writes that she refers to herself as lying for almost 3 years on a bed of illness. The extreme kind of asceticism, another word I'm not sure if I'm pronouncing it right, but if I just say it confidently enough, the extreme asceticism of some medieval saints, where they kind of deliberately lived in like very harsh, disciplined conditions for religious reasons, would certainly have had a negative and long-term impact on one's health. Some, kind of like Radegund of Poitiers comes to mind, participated in behaviour that actually harmed themselves, though I don't think she ever participated in something that would have disabled her. But a more kind of common way, though not much less dangerous, ascetic behaviour was extreme fasting. Margaret of Scotland, for example, her biographer Turgot explains that in the 40 days before Easter and Christmas respectively, she fasted so excessively that she, quote, "suffered a bitter sickness of the stomach up to her death." Illness is obviously not necessarily disabling, but he goes on to report that the priest who attended Margaret at the time of her death said she had been unable to, quote, "sit on a horse for at least half a year and even rarely well enough to rise from her bed." It's not only individual saints that provide examples of disability. One of the defining features of sainthood is the ability to perform miracles, sometimes in their lifetime but also after their death. This latter type was especially lucrative, as it usually allowed the monks who were caring for the saint's tomb or their relics to benefit from pilgrimage tourism, as people sought saintly solutions to their problems, and many of these problems were related to health. In the Miracula of St. Margaret of Scotland, collected in the 13th century by monks at Dunfermline, we see listed again and again different injuries or long-term health issues for which the pious supplicant sought help. Of course, that inclusion in this text is dependent on the affirmation of Margaret's kind of saintly powers. These people were cured, basically. Cameron McNab's discussion of miracle narratives argues that these conditions were usually presented as, quote, something that needed to be cured. But disabilities don't have to be incurable to have a disabling impact on people, and so we still get evidence of kind of long-term and chronic health issues, as well as how individuals and communities kind of responded to disability. A few examples include, there was a poor little woman, English by birth and race, living in the eastern regions of that people, who was afflicted for a long time with a very serious ailment. Her arm from the shoulders to the tip of her fingers was so weakened by swelling of the skin and flesh that she had been unable to lift it by her own strength and had to support it in a sling around her neck. Moreover, for 9 years, she was unable fully to close or fully to open her hand. Another woman who, for the space of 5 years, had lost the use of her eyes and was also struck by such severe paralysis in all her limbs that she could make no effort or movement in her entire body. Another entry in the Miracula describes like the supplicants, quote, weighed down with infirmities of mind or body, flocking to her tomb on the day in which her remains were due to be translated, which is basically where they take it from where they are to kind of a more illustrious position in the church. I think they put her underneath an altar. The writer reveals that on this night, 3 miracles occurred. A deaf woman spoke, a blind man was given sight, and the arm of a girl which had been dried up and consumed by a cancerous disease was restored to its original health. In the town of Dunfermline, there was a woman called Avicia who for a long time had been badly affected by weakness of the eyes. Eventually, she completely lost the power of sight. A monk called Adam, who endured a very serious illness for 3 years. A woman with dropsy, who travelled around the whole of England for 7 years, visiting the shrines of saints, seeking relief but not finding it. And a priest called Donald lay sick in bed for 4 months and 7 days, suffering a very severe physical infirmity. And that really is just some of them. There's, I think, there's something like 60 miracles. It's hard to know how much of kind of a cross-section you're getting from, because some of these entries are not very detailed at all, so it's kind of hard to know like what cross-section of the population you are getting. And there's some obviously like William of Inverkeithing who are named, with some of them you're told where they're from, there's some from England, but it shows that people were living with disabilities to kind of, you know, some quite successfully, others less so, for a long period of time. Miracle narratives are just one example of the documentary evidence that we have for these everyday disabled people. For example, petitions submitted by those seeking tax exemptions in 14th century Dijon has plenty of people kind of pleading poverty because their health has left them unable to work, showing that even before capitalism, this kind of capacity to work was still holding sway over the lives of disabled people. There's mentions of blindness, weakness and infirmity, gout, paralysis, a bad leg, some form of kind of kidney stones with quite explicit detail, long-term sickness, disabilities that have come with age or injury. For example, there is a carpenter living in Dijon who has been sick for a long time and is bedridden because of a piece of wood nearly killed him. Another has had a bad leg for the past 5 years and so much and so seriously impaired that he is on the verge of being disabled and that it has to be cut or amputated. In the face of such evidence, of such a range of evidence from the very top of society to the kind of nameless plebs, it would just be absurd to declare that disability was an insurmountable obstacle in the pre-modern world, including, of course, medieval Europe. But to return to the matter at hand, the original comment about pre-modern disabled people not surviving infancy. The ignorance of that, and I do mean ignorance in the very literal way, that ignorance of that comment cannot be addressed solely by kind of listing examples and discussing terminology. I want to deconstruct the unspoken assumption behind this statement, which is that the past was worse and today is better. That the history of humanity is one of linear, inexorable progress. That we have gone from a state of existence, you know, that was nasty, brutish and short, and now live in a more enlightened, liberal and progressive world. This perspective is sometimes called Whig history, Whig history is quite a loaded idea, which is often tied to colonialism and the idea that Western civilization was reaching an apex and that it was the West's responsibility to get the rest of the world up to speed by any means necessary. And in terms of disability history, this approach kind of holds as common sense that things are better for disabled people, that ableism is, you know, a thing in the past. It might also reflect kind of the idea that disability has been fixed by modern medicine. I'm not claiming that views agreeing with the original comment are some kind of vanguard of imperialism and Western exceptionalism, but I am claiming that these foundational myths on which modernity rests lead to inaccurate assumptions. So, was the past terrible? Many historians would say yes. Irina Metzler outlines at length the kind of traditional assessments of disability history in the medieval era. A 1932 book by H.W. Haggard called The Lame, the Halt and the Blind, The Vital Role of Medicine in the History of Civilization treads the kind of traditional Dark Age myth about the medieval period, while casting disabled people as kind of a social ill to be remedied. To quote Metzler, here again, the dominant discourse is progressionist. Everything in the past, and of course especially in the medieval dark ages of popular imagination, is seen as filthy and generally unhealthy, and only modern science can save people. Haggard did not even pretend anymore to actually write about disabled people, as is evident from the title alone, instead seeing disability purely as a medical problem of the past which civilization has overcome. Metzler kind of summarizes much of the scholarship on medieval disability history thus. Quote, the medieval period has been viewed by the medical historians, until fairly recently at least, as an unwelcome interruption in the glorious advancement of medical science from classical antiquity to the present day, with at best an apparent stagnation, or at worst even collapse, of medical knowledge during that time. I have kind of alluded to my gripes with a lot of the way the medieval period is characterized, and I will do an entire video of that, but I need to be brave because I think all the modernists are gonna yell at me. The views that Metzler outlines are not exclusive to kind of scholarship and academia. Quite understandably, given that this was the state of historiography until kind of the latter half of the 20th century, plenty of disabled people have expressed similar views. Metzler quotes an actor, Stacey Keach, who declared, quote, had I been born in the Middle Ages, I would never have lasted. I would have been instantly killed because children like me would have been considered the instruments of the devil. Now, I'm not going to deny another disabled person's kind of right to feel that way. As a disabled person, I don't want to go and live in the medieval period. I don't think that the attitudes, I'll kind of get more into this in a moment, but I want to be respectful of the fact that other disabled people are allowed to have different feelings towards this than I do, if that makes sense. You know, it would be monumentally foolish to say that disabled people just had it easy before modernity. Modern medicine has turned so many conditions that would have been death sentences into stuff that is manageable, like mine, or even curable. But this kind of dogmatic belief that the medieval period was almost inherently bad, that the misery was kind of inescapable and inevitable, that needs examining. Philanthropy existed, and the medieval world was no stranger to it. Although today we might kind of look more to the government and the state to assist the vulnerable, there were frameworks in place to support disabled people and kind of treat and manage ill health generally, chronic or otherwise. Most famously, hospitals. Tiffany Ziegler emphasizes kind of the centrality of monasteries and monastic communities in providing care to those in need in the early Middle Ages, but argues that there was a shift in the high medieval period towards municipal hospitals run by religious institutions, but kind of funded by civic philanthropy and fueled by, as Ziegler states, community spirit and a desire to help one's neighbour. The very word hospital comes from the Latin for host. Ziegler goes on to explain that new urban hospitals arose at a rapid rate and they owed their creation to various members of the medieval community who made endowments and donations. Kings, ecclesiastical lords, burghers and confraternities who shared in the idea that they were all part of one big commonwealth. These hospitals cared for the sick and the injured, and they often administered medical care, but also spiritual care, as pivotal to this system was Christianity. I think it's very easy to look back on pre-modern Christianity with a real cynicism, kind of assuming that those in charge saw religion as little more than a means to gain and hoard more wealth and more power. And let me be clear, it wasn't not a means to gain and hoard more wealth and more power, but Christianity remained a fundamental component of existence to pre-modern Europeans, and they sincerely believed in some, if not all, of its tenets, one of which is usually termed caritas, which refers to kind of a Christian love of humankind and charity. In England, some of these hospitals included one from the 7th century onwards, Whitby in Yorkshire, St John's Hospital at Canterbury, which was established in the 11th century, and St Mark's in Bristol, which was founded in the 13th century. Almshouses also existed, which gave kind of long-term shelter for the disabled and the aged infirm. This care was often quite paternalistic and would probably be considered patronising today. But as any disabled person will tell you, paternalistic philanthropy is still thriving today. Yet the role of religion was not always benevolent, and the church is usually kind of credited with entrenching and upholding an incredibly influential, damaging view of disability and illness that it resulted from sin. Various religious texts describe individuals who were struck with chronic diseases due to a sinful act or impious behaviour. Bede's biography of St Cuthbert, for example, has the saint describing himself as being, for his sins, bound by this infirmity. In the life of St Margaret of Antioch, before her execution, Margaret is shown praying that any household which venerates her will not be born of a child that is blind, nor halt, meaning kind of a mobility impairment, nor dumb, nor deaf, nor vexed by an unclean spirit. And as Leah Pope Parker explains, this is kind of a moralisation of disability. Also in St Margaret of Antioch's Vita, the ignorance of pagans is portrayed as like disability. Their kind of pagan idols are described as, quote, dumb and deaf. But this ideological framework may have been less than universal. Frank M. Napolitano, when discussing a 14th century performance of Christ's entry into Jerusalem, states that, quote, associations between sin and disability are, in the Christian scriptures at least, the exception rather than the rule. He argues that this performance...
So my camera overheated a couple of times when I was filming this, and thus what Frank M. Napolitano is arguing was almost lost to the vagaries of technology. So I will just outline it now. Basically, this performance of Christ's entry into Jerusalem that was being performed in York, he argues that this performance, quote, provides scarce linkage between sin and literal disability. In fact, the play seems to subvert any relationship between disability and sin in a series of interactions between Jesus and three marginalised individuals. No evidence exists for the sinfulness of Cessus or Claudius, the first two characters to whom, besides his disciples, Jesus speaks. So he was basically saying that in this performance of that kind of like biblical passage, even though there was kind of an opportunity perhaps to link sin and disability, they didn't. So that was kind of his argument, saying that it wasn't this kind of like universal belief that all disability and disease resulted from sin. So there you go. Also, do not take, I should have maybe said this earlier, do not take a drink every time I say the word quote. Like, it was important that I said it, because A, you know, me thinking, oh, I'm an academic little video essay, that I've got to kind of like make it clear when I'm using other people's words, but also because some of the words and phrases were slightly outdated. But yeah, I said the word quote so many times. So I don't know if I'm sorry for it, but you have to live with it either way. Peace.
Returning to the life of St. Cuthbert, Bede describes a man seeking Cuthbert's help for his wife, who was, quote, ill at the point of death and out of her senses. The man explains his fear that Cuthbert will see his wife and believes that the illness has resulted from her, quote, having been a false servant of the Lord and that her faith was not real. Basically, he's scared that Cuthbert will see his wife and because she is ill, assume that she has sinned. But Cuthbert replies that his wife will be cured and assures the man that, quote, not only the wicked but the innocent are sometimes permitted by God to be afflicted in body and are even taken captive in spirit by the devil. Now, this does not to any extent kind of disprove the idea that pre-modern Christianity saw illness and disability as the result of sin, but I think it manages to complicate that idea somewhat. You know, pre-modern Christendom was enormous, encompassing various kind of traditions, scriptural interpretations, sects, and customs. Not everyone was going to agree. Ableism certainly existed, but so did compassion and caritas, goodwill and charity. I think to assume that all disabled people were just viewed with abject horror and kind of left out for the wolves clings perhaps onto some of the more kind of modern misconceptions of the medieval. But it's not just historic misconceptions at play here. Part and parcel of this kind of progressionist approach, as Metzler calls it, she also refers to it as culturally optimistic at one point, is that things are better now in modernity than they were in the past. You know, surely a combination of modern medicine and societal compassion has overcome the issues encountered by disabled people. And of course, it has enabled the treatment, management, or cure of various health conditions and thus disabilities with more safety, efficacy, and reliability. Unfortunately, that same modern medical scientific tradition has played a role in one of the most significant issues faced by disabled people in modernity. Eugenics. Eugenics is the idea that society and humanity can kind of be selectively bred to be, quote, better. And better in this context is almost universally understood to mean able-bodied with no kind of mental health issues. The term eugenics was coined in 1883 by Francis Galton and promoted almost as common sense by medical and scientific experts in the 19th and 20th century. Winston Churchill was very much in favour of the, quote, confinement, segregation and sterilisation of a class of persons contemporarily described as the feeble-minded. Eugenics kind of goes hand in hand with kind of white supremacist race science, which was something Churchill was also not unfamiliar with. An example of eugenics, a real example, is the sterilisation of disabled people. In 1927, the American Supreme Court ruled that intellectually disabled people could be subject to forced sterilisation and were, possibly in their thousands. Eugenics doesn't always involve a medical procedure. It might involve kind of coercing or even bribing certain groups of people to take birth control. Nor does eugenics always link to kind of reproduction explicitly. It can be achieved by various means. One ongoing example of this in the UK is austerity. Austerity politics, in the UK at least, that kind of insists, you know, there's no money left to provide for the most vulnerable by underfunding the NHS and kind of making the welfare system almost impossible to navigate, has provided eugenics via economic policy. By depriving disabled people of financial resources adequate to enable them to participate in society, by reducing their quality of life and economic security, disabled people are forced either to kind of work regardless of their actual capability to do so, or to simply live on scraps. Both of these outcomes minimise the likelihood of disabled people having families of their own, as well as potentially shortening their own lifespan. This is modernity. This is a world with the Equality Act, and yet each policy of the UK government seems to twist the knife in further and will continue to do so while the Conservative government fails to address the cost of living crisis and while the major political parties kind of refuse to promise an end to austerity and while the capitalist hellscape in which we exist continues. Modern initiatives that may even have kind of seemed well-meaning sometimes have quite sinister outcomes, such as the institutionalization of disabled people through asylums and other medical facilities. Even a well-managed institution of this type risks kind of segregating disabled people from their friends, their family and their community. Not to mention the medical treatment offered or sometimes implemented without consent to disabled people, such as lobotomies, electroconvulsive shock therapy. These are all the product of modernity, of this miracle that is modern medicine. Now, if this was an actual academic paper, I would not be about to issue the following disclaimer, but this is the internet, so I am categorically not saying that things used to be better for disabled people, that the pre-modern world was some utopia for the crippled, nor am I saying that modern medicine has done nothing but destroy the lives and well-being of disabled people. I am simply inviting you to consider that things are less clear-cut, to think about how the kind of linear Whig history, progressivist, whatever you want to call it, that approach has allowed the germination of the comment that is at the very heart of this video. I hope that my myriad examples, and you know, these are truly just a few. Some of the other ones that I had written down was Richard III, Aelred of Ravaux, the painter Quintus Pedius, Joanna of Castile, Marcus Sergius Silus. There are prehistoric remains showing kind of severe but healed injuries, and all the nameless people who left behind no evidence of their disabled existence. As I said, this is a topic close to my heart, as it both kind of touches on my personal circumstances, but also my participation in the wider campaign to make the medieval better understood. I would love to hear about any other examples you might have come across of pre-modern disabled people, especially in the far kind of distant past and also outside of Europe. So please drop that knowledge in the comments below. Once again, I would like to thank Jesse Zander for their contribution to this video, and I highly recommend you check out their work, including, of course, their book, The Real J.R.R. Tolkien, The Man Who Created Middle-earth, which is available in print or ebook anywhere books are sold. Thank you so much for watching this video, and until next time.